were legally trained to learn their criminal law, thanks to you in some way or other. You stated towards the end, and I think we all agree, that there clearly will be charter challenges. I guess the question for us is whether or not these challenges will be successful. I wonder if you could talk to us a little bit about Section 1 of the Charter. You've spoken a lot about Section 8, and you did mention in your brief that you agreed with, I guess it was Professor Hawk, that the infringements of Section 9 and 10B would be saved by Section 1. So I wonder, in the first part of my question, whether you would just to share with us why you think that would be. What is it about Bill C-46 that would justify, under Section 1, the infringement? And then I'm going to ask you sort of to walk us through Section 1 a little bit as it applies to random or mandatory testing.
Well, it's just that with the Oaks test, it started off as a very strong test. Is the law rational? Is it proportional? And is the good outweigh the bad? And we've had lots, and clearly at this point it's a policy debate. There's no doubt there's not sort of like legal tests. We're talking about, do the justices in the Supreme Court think that this law meets those sort of balancing test? And so far, probably the most spectacular saving of a law was indeed the arbitrary stops for looking for pair drivers. But I just make the point that there's not a single case that I'm aware of where the Supreme Court has actually said that a law that violates Section 8, unreasonable search and seizure, can be saved under Section 1. Nowhere. Hundreds of cases since 1982. And I think the reason for that is rather like if you go to another area like mandatory minimum punishments. So the question is it grossly disproportionate sentence? And here we have the previous government had put in place 100 or so mandatory minimums. And the courts have now given, under Section 12, the chance to attack them. Approximately two-thirds of all challenges under that section are successful. None of the courts go to Section 1 and say, well, if it's grossly disproportional, anyhow, it's good. And I think the same thing would happen with Section 8. You can't say, I've decided that it's unreasonable search and seizure. They didn't have a warrant. They didn't require reasonable and probable grounds. They didn't even require reasonable suspicion. So, but it's okay. I just don't see the court, unless it changes. Of course, court watchers like myself would probably need to get a life parliament. Supreme Court's change. The other thing I wanted to say was that, one of the questions is what's the remedy if you keep reasonable suspicion? There are some recent movements in the courts which talk about being less enthusiastic about using Section 24(2) to exclude evidence in breathalyzer cases, very recent from the Ontario Court of Appeal, case called Jennings. So. Sometimes the courts are saying we've got too technical and we shouldn't exclude it even if the police made a mistake. But I don't see the absence of reasonable suspicion as being technical. It's crucial.
Because as you mentioned properly, under Oaks and its progeny, it's a question of balancing the objectives of the law and the degree to which the law will achieve those objectives in a way that minimizes rights to the greatest extent possible. The government has brought forward, and we've heard evidence that the introduction of mandatory testing will likely significantly reduce the accidents and the harm that they cause on the road, even discounting for the differences between jurisdictions, and that despite our current laws, drivers escape detection at the roadside, and many are dying or injured every day. So if the evidence does establish that mandatory testing, notwithstanding the infringement of Section 8, and I agree with you that it infringes Section 8. Here I disagree with Professor Professor Hogg on his interpretation of Section 8. But if it nonetheless can be shown that the law will have a really material impact on reducing the carnage, which the court has said is a legitimate objective and an important objective, and that there is no better way to affect that serious reduction, would that not satisfy Section 1?
Well, everybody's relying on the empirical data of Professor Robert Solomon from Australia and New Zealand.
As interpreted by Robert Solomon, the data exists independent,
right.
I think.
So we haven't really got equivalent data in Canada at all. And so the value of having a Charter of Rights and Freedoms is that independent judges can exercise their powers mandated under the Charter to provide some balance against law and order groups. So, I mean, as I mentioned, the distracted driving. If I'm a parent of somebody who was killed, my daughter was killed by a distracted driver, I'm going to say, everybody who drives using an iPhone goes to jail or gets to be convicted. No excuses. And so that would be a law that you and I wouldn't like, I don't think. And it seems to me like I would need to be convinced that under a reasonable suspicion test, that a lot of drunk drivers are getting off. And as I said to you before, it seems to me, for example, when we have public holidays, there's suddenly an announcement of a big campaign against drunk driving, and the numbers drop. And then on Monday comes around, there aren't enough police officers to do it. So sometimes enforcement is not a matter of legal powers, it's a matter of, are there sufficient resources to do it? Politicians often talk big about whatever it is, like we need a mandatory minimum penalty to be tough on this type of crime, and then forget that the outcome there is that nobody pleads guilty anymore and it just clogs the courts and then their long charter challenges to upset the mandatory minimums. And I think that's what's going to happen here too on this one.